الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. My dear respected brothers and sisters and those who are listening online, there is no doubt that sitting in a circle of knowledge like this has tremendous benefit. From them, what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the collection of Imam al-Bukhari rahimah, Imam Muslim rahimahullah, on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiyallahu anhu, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Majtama'a qawmun fi baytin min buyutillah yatluna kitab Allah wa yatadarasunahu baynahum إلا نزلت عليهم السكينة وغشيتهم الرحمة وحفتهم الملائكة وذكرهم الله في من عنده." Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in this hadith collected by Imam Muslim rahimahullah on the authority of this noble companion Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu, and for those who don't know this noble companion, he is nicknamed Abu Huraira. And Abu Huraira, if you translate it, it is the father of the kitten. The father of the kitten, because he used to carry a kitten. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ, he gave him that name. The father of the kitten. And the Prophet ﷺ, he used to joke with his companions, but he would say only that which is true. And he used to be very gentle with them. He used to joke with them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His name is Abdul Rahman ibn Sakhr, the name of the Abu Huraira. Abdul Rahman ibn Sakhr al-Dawsi. Al-Dawsi referred to this tribe, Daws. So he is from them, so he is al-Dawsi. Like sometimes you hear al-Qahtani. Qahtani is from Qahtan, the tribe of Qahtan, or At-Tamimi, from Bani Tamim, or the like. So this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about the merits, fada'il, the merits of sitting in a circle of knowledge, in the masjid. So he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whenever a group of believers sit together, like this majlis, this gathering, sit together in one of the houses of Allah, al-masajid. Shows you the importance of the masjid, the superiority of the masjid. He said, reciting the book of Allah and studying it among themselves. It shows you the superiority of reciting the Quran, and also the superiority and the merits of understanding the Quran. Because the Quran requires understanding. It's good to recite it, but also with understanding. Then he said, except that the serenity will descend upon them. Serenity. And this serenity, how many people they run from one hospital to the next, and they cannot find serenity. They cannot find it. Some of them, they have to take pills to find their peace, and they cannot find their peace. All it takes is to come to the masjid and sit in the circles, you perform the salat, and you have serenity. You will never, I guarantee you, will never have stress. You will never have stress. Bi-idhnillah. Ala bi-dhikrillahi tatma'inul qulub. As Allah said in the Quran, in Surah Al-Ra'd. Ala bi-dhikrillahi tatma'inul qulub. With the remembrance of Allah, heart find ease. Wallahi, wallahi. Reciting the Quran, making the adhkar, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, subhanallah, wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, whoever says subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim, 100 times. While you're walking, while you're sitting down, say subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim, 100 times. Remember this. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. 100 times. You can count with your fingers. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim, like this. Until you finish 100. What is the reward? Prophet ﷺ, he said, whoever says this 100 times in a day, غُفِرَتْ دُنُوبُهُ وَلَوْ كَانَتْ مِثْلَ زَبَدِ الْبَحْرِ. Allahu Akbar. His sins would be forgiven even if they were like the foam of the ocean. Allahu Akbar. Even if they were like the foam of the ocean. Tremendous reward. Then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, except that the serenity and tranquility descend upon them, and the mercy of Allah covers them. The mercy of Allah covers those who are sitting in a circle of knowledge. And not only that, وَحَفَّتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. And the angels, they will encircle them. They are here. Because they are from the unseen, we cannot see them. You see? They're invisible from us. But they are here. They are in the masajid. When a circle of knowledge like this, the angels are here. And the angels encircle them. وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَهُ. Allahu Akbar. And Allah himself will remember them among those who are with him from the angels. Imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will mention your name among the angels. Subhanallah, if you have to travel from China to come here, it would be nothing. It would be nothing. Right or wrong? Because the reward is tremendous. Wallahi, wallahi. Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he traveled the distance of 1 month to hear one hadith. Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he traveled the distance of 1 month, ikhwan, 1 month, to hear one hadith of the Messenger of Allah from another companion. He heard the hadith from him. That's it. And he, as soon as he heard the hadith, he went back to Medina. One hadith. And the Salaf al-Salih, they used to travel, the righteous predecessors, from the Imma. When you hear their biography, and when you read what they had to go through, it's not easy. Because nothing comes just like that. But subhanallah, the reward is tremendous. Except that serenity descend upon them, and the angels, the mercy covers them, and the angels encircle them. Allahu Akbar. Another hadith, وَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ لَتَضَعُ أَجْنِحَتَهَا لِطَالِبِ الْعِلْمِ رِضَى بِمَا يَسْمَعُ. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the angels, they stop flying and they encircle the student of knowledge, and because they are pleased with what he's doing. Because knowledge is a mean to Jannah. Knowledge is a mean to Jannah. Then how are you going to know what is halal, what is haram without knowledge? You're going to be able to know. So you have to sit in a circle of knowledge and learn. And that's why Prophet ﷺ, he said, من يريد الله به خيرا يفقه في الدين. When Allah intends good for a servant, male or female, he grants them that tawfiq, that success to understand the religion. And when the Prophet ﷺ needed water, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he rushed and he brought him water. Abdullah ibn Abbas. Then Prophet ﷺ, he made dua for him. He said, Allahumma faqihu fi ddin wa alimu ta'wil. O Allah, grant him understanding of the religion. And teach him at-ta'wil, the explanation and the of tafsir al-Quran. And the dua of the Messenger of Allah, of course, is accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Abdullah ibn Abbas, he was actually the best when it comes to tafsir al-Quran. Abdullah ibn Abbas is number one when it comes to tafsir al-Quran, radiallahu anhu. It shows you when you have the zeal and you have ikhlas, sincerity, then Allah will make a way for you. Will make a way for you. وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَهُ. Allah mentions you among the high society, means the angels who are with him. وَمَنْ سَلَكَ طَرِيقًا in the same hadith, he said, وَمَنْ سَلَكَ طَرِيقًا يلتمس به علما سهل الله له به طريقا إلى الجنة. الله أكبر. And whoever seeks a path of knowledge, whoever seeks a path of knowledge, Allah will make a path easy for him to Jannah. So inshallah, today we're going to read from the 68 aspect of the aspect of the days of ignorance. Now, when we study this book, Ikhwan, we study this book so that we can understand the usul, the principles and the methodology, the manhaj, that the mushrikeen were upon, so that we oppose it, so that we can oppose it. So, the Shaykh, rahimahullah, he mentioned 128 aspects. 128 aspects. So he took this from the Quran. So he said, دعواهم العمل بما عندهم من الحق كقولهم نؤمن بما أنزل علينا مع تركهم إياه. From the aspect of the days of ignorance is that they claim that they will act upon what they have from the truth that was revealed to them through their prophet, but they will believe in that, but they will not believe in other than that. They will not believe, for example, in the Quran. They will not believe in the Quran. They will not believe in the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the reality, the one who does not believe in the Quran, he will not be a believer. And if he does not believe in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's not a believer either. And one time there was a debate between a Jewish rabbi and a Christian priest and a Muslim preacher. So the rabbi and the Christian priest, they told the Muslim preacher to speak. He told them, okay. He said, you Jews, you claim that if you believe in Musa, peace be upon him, you go to Jannah. And you Christians, you claim that if you believe in Isa, you'll go to Jannah. But the problem is that both of you don't believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Right? You don't believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he said, if that's the case, only Muslims will go to Jannah. Because you will not go. Because we believe in Musa and Isa, and we believe in Muhammad, but you don't. You understand? So the debate was over. طيب. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said here, نُؤْمِنُ بِمَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْنَا. They claim that they acted upon that what was with them from the truth, as is found in his saying, they say we believe in what was sent down to us, Surah Al-Baqarah. Well, in reality, they abandoned it. Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan al-Fawzan, he said, from the characteristics of the people of the days of ignorance is that the Jews would claim to act upon what they were upon from the truth, when they in fact abandoned it, as Allah says, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ آمِنُوا بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ قَالُوا نُؤْمِنُوا بِمَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْنَا ويكفرون بما وراءه وهو الحق مصدقا لما معهم. And when it is said to them, the Jews, believe in what Allah has sent down, they say, we believe in only what was sent down to us, and they disbelieved in that which came after it, whereas it is the truth confirming what is with them. Look, in the Torah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he mentioned him in Injil, in the Gospel as well. So now, when the revelation came to you from Allah, instead of preaching it and telling the people about it, they hid it. Wal-iyadu billah. They hid it. And they tempered with the book. Na'udhu billah min dalik. So basically, they hid the truth. They hid it, wal-iyadu billah. And they were arrogant and they did not want to accept what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is held that what was sent down to us means what was revealed to our messengers from the prophets of the tribe of Israel. This is since this ayah was revealed concerning the Jews. They say we believe in only what was sent down to us means that was revealed to the messengers sent to the tribe of Israel. Even though that which Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with did not contradict what their messengers came with. Because their messengers, they commanded the people with Tawheed, right or wrong. All the messengers. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he commanded the people with Tawheed. Then what's the difference? The same message. The same message. Because all the messengers they have the same da'wah, the same call. As Allah said in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهِ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ. And we have indeed sent in every nation a messenger proclaiming to them to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to worship Allah alone, and to stay away from false deities. So all the Prophet messengers, that was their da'wah. That was their call. They're all the same. And that's why Allah said about the people of Nuh, كَدَّبَتْ قَوْمُ نُوحٍ الْمُرْسَلِينَ هَكَدَا بِالْجَمْعِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the plural. كَدَّبَتْ قَوْمُ نُوحٍ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. The people of Nuh, they denied and they belied the messengers. Look, messengers. How many messengers were sent to them? Only one. Nuh, peace be upon him. But why would Allah use the plural? Shaykh Al-Allama Al-Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, he said because if someone disbelieved in one prophet, he disbelieved in all the prophets. Why? Because all these prophets were sent out by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He sent them out to the people with the same message, Tawheed. Ya qawmi, ibudu Allah, ma lakum min ilahin ghayru. O my people, worship Allah. You have no other deity worthy of worship except Him. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that He did not create jinn and human except to worship Him. This is the reason why Allah created the creation. And Shaykh al-Islam, he said, الْعِبَادَةُ إِسْمٌ جَامِعٌ لِكُلِّ مَا يُحِبُّهُ اللَّهُ وَيَرْضَهُ مِنَ الْأَقْوَالِ وَالْأَفْعَالِ الظَّاهِرَةِ وَالْبَاطِنَةِ. Shaykh al-Islam rahimahullah, he said, worship. That way you know what ibadah is. He said, worship is an inclusive term. Inclusive means general. It includes everything. Inclusive term that consists in it everything Allah loves. So in other words, if it is bid'ah, Allah will not love it. So he's very, very precise. Daqiq fil ibadah. So he said, everything that Allah loves and is pleased with. So if you do a good deed with ikhlas, sincerity, and accordance to the kitab and sunnah, in accordance to al-kitab wa sunnah, it's not an innovation. It's not an innovation. You have not innovated. You have not introduced something into the religion. You have ikhlas. You're doing it for the sake of Allah. At the same time, you're doing it in accordance with the kitab wa sunnah. What is the end result? It will be accepted, inshallah, and it will be valid. It will be valid. So now, we will give you an example. وَبِالْمِثَالِ يَتَّضَحُ الْمَقَالِ. With the example, the statement becomes clear. طيب. Now, الشيخ العلامة الفوزان حفظه الله, he said, if someone performed al-ghusl with the intention to clean himself up. With the intention to do what? Clean himself up. He said this ghusl is not valid for the salat. So you cannot use this ghusl. Naam. You did not make ghusl yet, basically. You are still in a state of janaba. You still have to make ghusl. Why? The intention. You see, It has to be in accordance with Al-Kitab wa Sunnah. Because this intention is what? It's not an act of worship. It's an act of habit. Likewise, Al-Allama Al-Uthaymeen, he said, rahimahullah, if someone performed wudu in hot weather, he wants to cool himself off. The weather is hot. So the salat comes and he goes and he prays. This salat is not valid. Why? Because this wudu that the person has done is not an act of worship. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. Actions are based on the intention and for each person what he intended. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he warned against innovations. And he used to say that before even the innovation started. Because there were no innovation in his lifetime, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But later on, you have different sects that emerge. Like Rafida, like Al-Khawarij, and other than them, Al-Mu'tazila, Al-Jahmiya, Al-Kullabiya, Al-Maturidiya, and other than them from the deviant sect. So, subhanAllah, the Prophet ﷺ used to say this on the minbar. He used to say, وَشَرَّ الْأُمُورِ مُحْدَثَاتُهَا وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ وَكُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَ وَكُلُّ ضَلَالَ فِي النَّارِ. He used to say, and the worst of the affairs are the newly invented matters. And every newly invented matter is a misguidance. And every misguidance leads to the hellfire. And also his companions, like for example, you find the statement of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. He said, اقتصاد في سنة خير من اجتهاد في بدعة. Subhanallah. اقتصاد في سنة خير من اجتهاد في بدعة. To be moderate when it comes to the sunnah is better than to be diligent when it comes to innovations. Because the innovator, he does not get closer to Allah. He's going to get farther away from Allah. Because Allah did not command you to do that. So, al-a'mal, they have to be in accordance with al-kitab wa sunnah, with ikhlas. So, Shaykh al-Islam, rahimahullah, he said that an act of worship, al-ibadah ismun jami', inclusive term, that consists in it, everything Allah loves and is pleased with. From the statement and the actions that are apparent and hidden. Statement like when you say, La ilaha illallah. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Adhkar. So you say this, Allah loves it. Kalimatan, habibatan ila rahman, taqilatan fil mizan, khafifatan ala lisan. The last hadith Sahih al-Bukhari, hadith Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there are two words. They're very light on the tongue, very heavy on the scale, yawm al-qiyamah, and they're dearer to Allah. Allah loves them. What are they? Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim, Allahu Akbar. This is the last hadith. And if you notice, Shaykh al-Abbad, our Shaykh al-Allama, Al-Muhaddith, Shaykh Muhsin al-Abbad al-Badr, hafidhahullah, he said that the first hadith Sahih al-Bukhari and the last hadith Sahih al-Bukhari, both of them hadith ahad. Ahad means they come from one route. Means the first hadith, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَلُ بِالنِّيَّةِ, hadith Umar ibn Khattab, actions are based on the intention. This hadith, no one is known to have reported this hadith from the Prophet ﷺ except Umar ibn Khattab. That's it. No other companions. Umar ibn Khattab. And the last hadith, Abu Huraira only. So they are hadith ahad. And the stance, mawqif ahl sunnah, the stance of the people of the sunnah, when it comes to hadith ahad, we accept them as long as they are authentic. Even if they are in the matters of belief. Even when they are in the matters of, because the people of bid'ah, they say, no. Hadith ahad cannot be a proof when it comes to the belief. Only the Quran and mutawatir, hadith mutawatir. Al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, they say, no, we don't differentiate between hadith mutawatir, which has been transmitted by a large number of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, 30, 40, 50, sometimes 70 sahabi would narrate a hadith from the Prophet ﷺ. And al-ahad is like one sahabi narrates. As long as the hadith is authentic, there's no issue in the chain of narrators, then al-hadith is authentic. Why? Because the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, all of them are udul. All of them are udul, reliable. They're all reliable. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has praised them from above the seventh heaven. Allah said in the Quran, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنْصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُونَ بِإِحْسَانِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. سبحان الله. الإمام الخطابي he said, Abu Bakr al-Khatib al-Baghdadi, Allah has praised them from above the seventh heaven, so there is no need for anyone to praise them after Allah praised them. That's it. If Allah praised them, that's it. It's enough. So Allah praised them from above the seventh heaven. So Allah said, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ, the foremost from the muhajirin, the migrants, who migrated from Mecca to Al-Madinah. Allahu Akbar. And they suffered a lot. They suffered a lot. It's not easy. They had to sacrifice. Some of them had to leave their wealth there. It's not easy. They were persecuted. Some of them were beaten and persecuted. Radiallahu anhum. And Allah chose them for his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they were the best. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, خير الناس قرني ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم. The best of the people are my people. Means the companions radiallahu anhum, they are the best. And then those who will come after them, التابعين, the students of the Sahaba. Like, for example, الإمام العالم الفقيه سعيد بن المسيب. سعيد بن المسيب is one of the تابعين. Actually, he's from كبار التابعين, from the major تابعين. And as a matter of fact, he's a student of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. So he learned from Abu Huraira. And by the way, he saw one time سعيد بن المسيب, he saw a man in the masjid performing the salat النفل, the optional prayer. But at the time of Nahi, prohibition. For example, when the sun is setting or the sun is rising, it's not permissible to pray at that time. طيب? Now this man, he was praying at those times. So Sa'id ibn Musayyib, he told him, لا تصلي في هذا الوقت. Do not pray at this time. So the man, he said, أتنهاني عن الصلاة؟ قال لا أنهاك عن مخالفة السنة. الله أكبر. سبحان الله العظيم. He said, do you prevent me from praying? He said, no. You're missing the point. I am preventing you from opposing the sunnah. You see, because the Prophet ﷺ, he told us in the hadith not to pray at this time. Look, subhanallah, al-wuquf inda sunnah. You stop with the sunnah, stop. And you proceed with the sunnah, proceed. That's it. كما قال الأوزاعي, نَدُرُ مَعَ السُنَّةِ حَيْتُ مَا دَارَتْ. Imam al-Awza'i, rahimahullah, he said, we follow the sunnah wherever the sunnah goes, we follow it. We follow the sunnah wherever the sunnah goes. So, the Shaykh, he said, it is held that what was sent down to them means what was revealed to our messengers from the prophets of the tribe of Israel. And it is believed in that which came after it, meaning everything beside it, from the books that would reveal to Isa and Muhammad, alayhim salatu wassalam. Whereas it is the truth, confirming what is with them, so that which Isa and Muhammad, alayhim salam, came with, was in conformity with what their prophet brought. And it clarified and corrected that which they had introduced into their book from distortion, lies, and misguidance. This is from one perspective. Look, so the sheikh, the reason now, look, these people, they are people of hawa, walayadu billah, people of desires. Because when Allah revealed to their prophet something that do this and don't do this. So what they did, they played with it. They changed. So they changed the ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Na'udhu billah min dalik. This is one of the worst crimes that you can commit when you change the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why Allah mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَإِذْ قُلْنَا ادْخُلُوا هَذِهِ الْقَرْيَةَ فَكُلُوا مِنْهَا حَيْثُ شِئْتُمْ رَغَدًا وَادْخُلُوا الْبَابَ سُجَّدًا وَقُولُوا حِطَّةٌ نَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ خَطَايَاكُمْ وَسَنَزِيدُ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said to them, when you enter the town and prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say, oh Allah, forgive us. حِطَّةٌ. Okay? Remember this word, حِطَّةٌ. حِطَّةٌ. طيب. So what they did, they added noon. حِنْطَة. Look. They changed the meaning of the word. Because الحِنْطَة, what does الحِنْطَة mean? Wheat. Wheat. القمح. Wheat. الحِنْطَة is wheat. طيب. And حِطَّة, forgiveness. It's like the difference is like the night and the day. So they added the noon to hitta. طيب. الإمام القيم, he said, نون اليهودي ولا مجهمي هما عند الله سواء. الإمام القيم, he said, the noon of the Jews, this one. Just hitta, hinta. They added the noon. Okay. ولا مجهمي. لام of الجهمية. Anybody knows what لام of الجهمية mean? You don't know. Okay. Write this down. Lamb of Al-Jahmiyyah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa. Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa. The Most Gracious rose over the throne in a way that befits His Majesty. This is the Aqidah of Al-Sunnah. Istawa ala al-Arsh bitariqatin taliqu bijalalihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah rules over the throne in a way that befits His Majesty. طيب. Now, Al-Jahmiyyah, you have to understand where they're coming from. Okay. Al-Jahmiyyah, they're from their methodology when it comes to belief. When it comes to the attribute of Allah. Because Allah has attributes. طيب. They negate. They don't affirm. Do you understand what negate means? Anyone can give me an example of negate? Huh? What does it mean? Can you give me an example? What does negate mean?
They don't follow or don't believe.
Well, no, not that. But I need an example.
They reject the attributes
of Allah. Okay, can you give me an example? Okay. All right. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa huwa sami'u al-basir. He is the all-hearing, the all-seeing. Right? So al-sunnah wal-jama'ah, they affirm that Allah sees in a way that befits His Majesty. And He hears in a way that befits His Majesty. Al-jamiyah, they say, sami'un bila sam'a. Kalam al-majaneen. This is the speech of the insane people. They say, sami'un bila sam'a. He hears without hearing. It doesn't make sense. So that's why one of the imams, I believe Hamad ibn Zayd. I believe Hamad ibn Zayd, rahimahullah. There was two. Hamad ibn Salama and Hamad ibn Zayd. طيب. One of them, Hamad ibn Zayd, I believe. He said, Al-Jahmiyyah, they are like a man who said, I have a palm tree in my yard. So they asked him, they said, can you describe to us this palm tree? He said, it doesn't have a trunk. It doesn't have any leaves. And it doesn't have any fruits on it. Then in the end, they told him, you don't have a palm tree. Do you have a palm tree? You don't have a palm tree. Because you say, it doesn't have a trunk. It doesn't have leaves. It doesn't have any branches, nothing, no fruits. Then you don't have a tree. So that's why Imam al-Qayyim, he said, al-mushabbihu ya'budu sanaman, wal-mu'attilu ya'budu adaman. Subhanallah. He said, the one who likens Allah to his creation, al-mushabbih, ya'budu sanaman, he worships an idol. Because anything that you imagine is just from your brain. Has nothing to do with the reality. This is only in your brain. Allah is not like what you imagine. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is nothing like him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now, and then he said, وَالْمُعَطِّلُ يَعْبُدُ عَدَمًا. And the one who negates the attribute of Allah, he worships what? Nothingness. He worships what? Nothingness. Nothing. Why did they negate? Anybody knows? Limada. Limada. Why? What did they negate?
They didn't want to liken Allah to his
creation. Yes, because they claim if we affirm, we say Allah speaks in a way befits his majesty, then we liken him to his creation. But this is not true. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Quran, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. And Allah spoke to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam in a way that befits his majesty. Now, going back to Imam al-Qayyim, he said, the noon of the Jews and the lamb of al-Jahmiyyah, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, al-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa. Al-Jahmiyyah, they say, it doesn't mean istawa. It means istawla. Okay, I want you to pay attention on this. Stawa rose over. Okay? Rahmanu al-Arshi Stawa means the most gracious rose over the throne in a way befits his majesty. Now when you say Stawla, you change the meaning. The meaning is completely like the night and the day. Stawla means conquered, dominate. Conquered and dominate. Now, when you say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dominated the throne and conquered the throne, we have two major problems. We have two major problems. What are they? Anybody can tell me?
One is saying...
Naam, tafadhal.
One is he has to make an effort.
Right, right. Yes, go ahead.
He had to overtake somebody.
He had to overtake another deity. It does not befit his majesty. لا يليق بجلاله سبحانه وتعالى. He had to overpower and overtake another deity. You see how dangerous this statement are? Because these people, they run away from tashbih. As Sheikh Al-Abbad said, he said, فروا من التشبيه فوقعوا فيما هو أشد منه فوقعوا في التعطيل فكانوا كالذي يستجيروا من الرمضاء بالنار. Sheikh Al-Abbad, he said they run away from tashbih, from likening Allah to his creation, and they fell in something worse than that, which is negating the attributes. So he said they have become like someone who's running from the heat of the desert, the Ramda, and he fell into the fire. Subhanallah al-Azim. He ran away from the heat of the desert. You should go to the shade at least. He's going to the fire. Look, subhanallah, al-bid'ah is very dangerous. And all this comes from what? A bad qiyas, corrupt analogy. And that's why al-ulama, they say, awwalu man qasa iblis. Awwalu man qasa iblis. Wama ubidat ash-shamsu wal-qamaru illa bil-maqayis. Wallahi. Ulama, they say, the first one that he used analogy, al-qiyas, is Iblis. How did he use analogy? Anybody can give me an ayah from the Quran? How did he use analogy? Iblis. What did he tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when Allah commanded him to prostrate to Adam? What did he say? أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْهُ خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ طِينٍ. So he said, I am better than Adam. You created me from fire. So he felt very proud. That he thought that fire is better than clay. But the reality, clay is better than fire. You see, because clay is what? Stable. Fire is what? Wild. Right or wrong, Ikhwan? Okay. What else can you do with the clay? Anybody knows? You know, school kids. Come on. What can you do with clay?
You could build.
You, what can you build? House, mud houses. You know, they still exist today. Wallahi. Beautiful. And by the way, these mud houses, in the winter, they're very warm. And in the summer, they're very cool. You'll be shocked. الرجوع إلى الأصل أصل. When you go back to the origin, is the origin, right? You're going back to the origin, is the origin. Look, subhanAllah. Going back to the old time where people lived like very easy life. It was not complicated. But now look at technology. With all this technology that they have, and they have so much problems, subhanAllah. So the first one that he used al-qiyas, bad analogy, and corrupt analogy is Iblis. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all al-ilm al-nafi, al-amal salih. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.